John 3. Mark. Oh, wait, you're already there. If you could read this, how much do you usually read?
About 3 or 4.
Like from five to eight.
Five to eight?
Yeah. Could you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Because that's what I'm preaching on.
All right.
Okay.
Sounds good. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sunday. Glad to see you all in the house of the Lord this morning. Our call to worship is from Proverbs, page 764 in the Pew Bible. It's chapter 3, verses 1 through 2. My son, do not forget my teaching, but let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days and years of life and peace they will add to you. May the Lord grant his blessing upon the reading of his word. And let's stand and sing our first hymn this morning. I will sing the wondrous story, number 295. Our scripture reading this morning is going to come from John, but it's going to be different than what's in the bulletin this morning. We're going to read scripture that Pastor Rick is going to preach on later, so listen with your hearts and your minds so that we're prepared for his teaching later. It's on page 1262, John chapter 3, verses 5 through 8. Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from and where it is going. So it is everyone who is born of the Spirit." May the Lord grant his blessing upon the reading of his word. So, welcome this morning. A reminder that today we are going to have our quarterly meeting right after service, so please stick around for that. Bible study is happening every Thursday at 7 p.m. We would love to see you all right here for the message as we hear it from Pastor Zach. Please note that next Sunday there will be a special congregational meeting, again after service, where we're going to take a vote on the next step for LSBC. So if you could please make a point to be here next Sunday, that would be great. In your bulletin, you've got two flyers. The first is for Operation Christmas Child. The due date for these boxes is coming up November 5th, so that's what, three weekends from now? So please make sure that you are collecting your items, filling your boxes, and bringing them in. Reminder that you don't have to take care of any of the postage because we have an angel donor who's taking care of that for everybody. So thank you to that donor. We really appreciate it. The second bulletin is for an updated church directory. If you could fill this out for you and your family and leave it in the narthex as you leave, we want to have updated information for those people who are attending our services, and so that we know, especially these questions down here, the best way that you'd like to be contacted, so that if the church has a message for you or the elders want to reach out to you, we know the best way to do so. That is it for announcements. I do have some prayer requests to please keep in mind. The first prayer request is for Fraser Allberger. He was in a car accident this past week. He was taken to Cooper Hospital because he had back pain and because of other instant health issues, they wanted to be safe, so they took him to Cooper. He is still there, but they are hoping to move him to a rehab facility either today or tomorrow. He had to stay a couple of extra days because his blood pressure dropped and some kidney issues as well. So please keep Fraser in your prayers. Please also pray for Arlene Cripps. She's going to be undergoing knee surgery tomorrow. So we'll keep her in our prayers as she undergoes surgery and also goes through rehab as well. Please add to your prayer list a coworker of Sandy Massantonio. Her name is Missy. She's having breast cancer surgery tomorrow. So she will also, in our extended church family, we pray for those friends and family who don't come to our services, but you know, we know that they need support, and that's what we can offer them prayerfully. So please keep her in mind. And Sandy also shared that there's a little boy in Gia's class. His name is Michael. He's 8 years old. He is in the hospital with heart failure. So please pray for Michael and his family as they seek treatment for him. That is it for the announcements this morning. I'm going to call the ushers forward so we can give unto him our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. Let's stand and sing our doxology together. Father, we thank you for bringing everyone here together in your house of worship so that we can honor you. And we are so blessed to receive these gifts in your name. And we praise you, and we ask that you bless us as we use these gifts in accordance to your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And now we've come to our time of prayer together, where everyone will have some time to speak to Jesus, what's on your heart, and then we'll join together in a united prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, every Sunday we get to come into your house of worship, and it's just an honor to be here, to be amongst fellow believers, and to be able to share your word and the joy of being saved. We thank you for bringing us together from all different parts of the country and the world, and just being able to celebrate life. And we are just so thankful for the freedom to do so. And Lord, we ask that you continue to look after this church as you have for so many years. We thank you for the men who've come and supported this church, given of their own time, so that we can keep sharing the word and the gospel. And we look forward to having a shepherd of our own someday soon, so that we can continue to do your good works. Lord, there are many people in this congregation and throughout our friends and family circles who need your guidance and your support, your healing powers, and just your comfort. And Lord, we lift their names up to you. Please look after Fraser, Arlene, Missy, Michael, and so many others who are in our hearts individually, who need you today and every day. And we hope that they feel we are with them, and that most importantly, you are with them. Lord, we also ask that you bless this country. We are divided in so many ways, but there is greater good to humanity, and we are hopeful that that greater good just pervades everything that happens here at home. But also, we ask that you do miracles in Israel and Palestine, and you look out for the innocent who need to be supported and looked after, because what's happening is not of their will, and they don't deserve to suffer for others. Lord, we are just so grateful for everything that you do for us today, tomorrow, in the future. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing our next hymn, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus," which is hymn number 489.
Thank you.
Next, we're going to have some special music from Lori, sharing a special message that I feel is very appropriate. Thank you, Lori. That was beautiful. Next, we have our message to be shared with by Pastor Rick. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Lori. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
How about those Phillies and those Eagles? A round of applause for them. Well, it is so good to see you guys again. It's been a while. I took a month off, right? Right, Harold? Harold, you guys are so blessed to have Harold to pursue people to fill the pulpit. You know, he was a recruiter and he's a good salesman. Like I said, he doesn't take no for an answer. I like that. We missed you guys because we missed a month. And I understand that you have somebody potentially that could come. And so we're praying that this would happen for you guys, that you would have a regular shepherd that's here. So, what I want to do this morning is talk about something that is kind of glazed over, I think, when we talk about being a Christian, because there's a little bit of a negative connotation associated with this particular phrase. Who's ever heard of a guy named Chuck Colson? Raise your hand. Prison fellowship. Well, Chuck Colson was Richard Nixon's chief legal advisor, and then he got caught up in all the Watergate stuff, and so they send him off to prison. He's in prison. He comes to know Christ. He writes a book called Born Again, and it was a bestseller. And then Jimmy Carter becomes president, and he declares to the nation that he is a born-again Christian. And all of a sudden, in our culture, the phrase born-again Christian became a part of our nomenclature, right? And like a lot of things that get caught up in our language, it got muddied, you know, and distorted, and fanatics and flash in the pan, sort of really not Christians and critics, kind of made the idea of a born-again Christian, it put a negative connotation to it. You know, if I said to you, do you have a positive or a negative view if I say someone's a born-again Christian? And most people, it's not necessarily positive. But we as the church shouldn't let society hijack words that are biblical and phrases that are biblical. So what I want to talk about this morning is what it means to be a born-again Christian. And this is so important because, as Jessica read, Jesus said to Nicodemus, you must be born again. He said, if you want to go into the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. It's a prerequisite. And it's one of the most important things taught in Scripture. It's eternally important that you understand what it means to be born again and how to be born again. Because the theme of being born again exists in Scripture. It's introduced by our Lord in the first 15 verses of John 3. John 3, 1 to 15 is our text this morning. So open up your Bibles if you have them. And those verses lead up to the most popular verse in the Bible. I read a report this week from Google Analytics, done in conjunction with Bible Gateway, about the most popular verse in the Bible. What do you think it is? John 3:16. You drive down the road, you see signs that say John 3:16. You watch the games on TV, and somebody's got a poster, and it just says John 3:16. You see it on bumper stickers. What does it say? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever shall believe in him, I know the King James, shall never perish but have everlasting life. There it is, right? A lot of people know that. But how many people know the context in which John 3:16 was spoken? Not as many. You know, it's never wise to cherry pick Scripture. To open your Bible and open your Bible and point at something and say, all right, what does this say? Judas went and hung himself. Oh, well, you open up your Bible again. Go and do likewise. You've got to be careful about cherry picking the Scriptures. It's unwise. So what I want to do this morning is go through verse by verse, John 3, 1 to 15, and come away with what it means to be born again and how one is born again. And I know that this is maybe a familiar text to a lot of you, but my prayer has been all week that it would be fresh for you this morning. And if you are not yet born again, that today would be the day that you are born again and made a new creation. So let's read our text. John 1, verses 3 to 15. It says, now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the ruling Jewish council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miracles and signs you are doing if God were not with him. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. How can this be? How can a man be born again when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born. Jesus answered, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but Spirit gives birth to Spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asks. You are Israel's teacher, Jesus said, and you do not understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen, but still you do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak to you of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who is from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall never perish, but have everlasting life. There it is. There's the foundation of the most popular verse in the Bible. You know, that study from Google Analytics, 2.1 million people a month look up John 3:16. That's the number one verse. 50 million people a year go online to find out what John 3:16 says, and they probably read it, but they don't read the foundation of it, the context in which it was spoken. So we see two things, right? We see, number one, that Jesus spoke John 3:16 in a one-on-one conversation with a man named Nicodemus. That's obvious. The other thing we note is that the word born is used 8 times in these 15 verses. So every other verse contains the word born or birth, born from above, born of the Spirit, born again. When you're reading the scriptures and you want to find out the theme of a section of scripture, one of the things you want to look to do is look for repeated words. And so when we see the word born used 8 times in 15 verses, we say, aha, the context of John 3:16 is being born again. And it's stated most clearly in John 3:7, where Jesus says point blank to Nicodemus, you must be born again. And this morning, I want everyone to hear that as if Jesus was saying it directly to you, that you must be born again personally, face to face, because that's the reality of what he says. You must be born again. If you're not born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. It's a prerequisite. You know, so it's of eternal importance that we understand what it means. So let's go back through this, and we're going to find out this morning exactly what it means to be born again. In verse 1, we read that now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. We all know Nicodemus, right? We've heard of him. He shows up again in Scripture. Where does he show up after this encounter with Christ? What's that? Yeah, he shows up and he helps bury Jesus. So he gets saved through this conversation. But he was a member of the ruling Jewish council and he was a Pharisee. So we learn these two things, that he was a Pharisee, which means that he was a very moral man, a very upright man, that he spent his entire life memorizing the Word of God, the law of God, trying to keep it and encouraging others to do the same. He was a good guy. Not only that, he was a member of the ruling Jewish council. It was called the Sanhedrin. It was 70 members, 70 Pharisees who kind of ruled Egypt from a religious or moral perspective. So Nicodemus was not only a moral man, an upright man, but he was a successful man. He was wealthy. He was influential. He was well respected by everyone in the community. They came to him and they learned from him. One commentator said this. He said that if we had lived during Christ's day, and we have been forced for some reason to choose a man to represent us, a man who would embody the best of our culture, our education, our religion, and morality, Nicodemus would have been a good choice. And I give you this description of Nicodemus because we should all recognize him, because a lot of us strive to be like him. A lot of us wish our kids and our grandkids would grow up to be like him. He's the kind of guy you would want your daughters to marry. He's successful, he's wealthy, he's moral, he cares about people. And we read that in verse 2 that he'd already come to some positive conclusions about Jesus. In verse 2 it says that Nicodemus came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miraculous signs you are doing if God were not with him. So he affirms that Christ's miracles are authentic, and they prove that he's a messenger sent from God. And, you know, this man, Nicodemus, he's drawn to Jesus. And we should take that seriously because, you know, he's a man that people came to learn from and they looked up to. And he recognized Jesus as someone that he could learn from and look up to. He felt like he could talk to Jesus, right? And so he greets him, and you almost sense that he's about to launch into a question. Like, he's got some things he wants to ask Jesus, but Jesus cuts him off. He kind of He breaks the flow of the conversation. And in essence, he says, Nicodemus, stop talking. Look at me and pay very careful attention to what I'm about to tell you. Verse 3, Jesus replied, he declared to this man, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of heaven unless he is born again. Now, what a way to begin a conversation. Doesn't it seem odd that he just breaks in and he makes this statement? And you know, he basically says that if you want to enter God's glorious presence when you die, you must be born again. And you know, we, in our church, we have a lot of people who are builders, who are good craftsmen and good at construction. I'm not, right, Dad? I'm not. But that's okay. Sometimes. So I want you to imagine with me something for a second. Pretend that you were a skilled carpenter, a skilled craftsman, and you had spent the past 20 years of your life building a house. And this house has become sort of a lifetime project for you. You purchased the land yourself. You got the equipment and you graded the land yourself. You prepared the land. You personally built the foundation and you personally selected every screw and nail and piece of lumber that went into this home. You've put your quality, the very, very, very best you can do, into this house. It's the pride and joy of your life. It's sort of become a monument to your excellence and your vision and your attention to detail and your work ethic. And over the years, you've continued to make improvements to your house. When people would come over to your house for gatherings, they always compliment you on your house. In fact, this house has become so closely associated with your identity that, you know, your house and you kind of go together. And then one day, you're at Home Depot, and you're fortunate enough to run into a man that you recognize from Architectural Digest magazine, or HGTV. And this guy is a master builder architect. He's famous for his residential and home designs and construction. And so you invite him to come and take a look at your house. And to your surprise, he agrees. So you are beside yourself with excitement that this guy, this master builder architect, is coming to see your house. And everybody tells you how wonderful your house is. And in the back of your mind, here's what you're thinking. I wonder if he can make some suggestions. Like he'll look around and say, you know, you could put crown molding in here and it would give a more regal appearance to this room. Or you know, maybe the deck could wrap around a little further. Or you could change this wall and it would give a better sense of space. And it would be a real improvement to your wonderful home. And so the master builder comes in and he walks around and he's silent. He's not saying anything. And eventually he looks up at you and he says, this entire house needs to be torn down, hauled off to the dump, and burned. In fact, I would bring a couple of triaxle dump trucks in here to haul out, you know, 6 or 7 loads of dirt because the soil's garbage too. You know, you would be devastated, wouldn't you? You'd say, you know, I spent my whole life building this house. What do you mean it needs to be torn down? And I want us to see that is exactly what's happening with Nicodemus here in this conversation with Christ. That you know, this was shocking. Here's this man at the pinnacle of his success, of financial success, of moral success. And, you know, Jesus in effect says to him this. He says, look, Nicodemus, you've come to me, and I know what you're thinking. You're thinking maybe there's something I can add that's missing from your already successful life. And I'm telling you, Nicodemus, that your whole life needs to be lived again. Everything you've worked for amounts to nothing when it comes to entering the kingdom of heaven. You must be born again. And an awful lot of people are like Nicodemus. You know, an awful lot of us have, you know, you have a good education or you're well-read, you have some solid achievements, you have a good sound work ethic, healthy relationships in your family, a good marriage, and you're an ambitious person, and you always want to strive for more. So if somebody comes along and says, you know, God can add up, you know, he can fill up what's missing in your life, you know, that makes perfect sense to you, doesn't it? Because you think, I'm not perfect. I have my faults. There's always things that I need God to forgive. So a message that says that you need Jesus to make it complete, just to top off your already great life, that appeals to us, right? You know, it appeals to our pride, is what it appeals to. Let Jesus fill up the God-shaped hole in your life. You ever hear that one? You ever hear that? Everyone has a God-shaped hole in their life, and only Jesus can fill it. You hear what that's saying? It's saying that everything in your life is fine. It's fine. You just need Jesus to fill in the holes. And that's not what the Bible says. The Christianity is not a self-improvement program. It's not a you do your best and God does the rest, program of salvation. And I want us to see that clearly this morning from this conversation. Jesus does not say, hey, Nicodemus, good job. You're really doing great. Everything in your life seems fine, but I'm going to give you that little something extra. He doesn't say that. He says, Nicodemus, your whole life needs to be remade. You must be born again, and unless that happens, you have no chance of seeing the kingdom of heaven. And, Nicodemus, you came here thinking that you're very close to the kingdom of God, and I'm telling you that you're nowhere near it. And it's devastating to this man. And let's not miss the fact that he says this to Nicodemus. He represents, us at our very best, this guy does. I wouldn't be surprised if he said this to the thief on the cross or the woman at the well. You've made a wreck of your life. You've become a thief. You become a prostitute. You need to start over again. He says this to Nicodemus, to man at his best. You must be born again. So here's the point. He's saying that the change that needs to happen in your life, the change that needs to happen in every life, is far more radical than you thought it was. And that's what Nicodemus is discovering here. And I just wonder, do you grasp this teaching in relation to your own life? Are you someone who thinks, I'm doing okay. I'm not a terrible person. I have some good opinions of Jesus, and the idea that he might be able to add something to my life, I like that. If that's you, listen to what Jesus says, that even at your very best, you're nowhere near the kingdom of heaven. You must be born again. So in verse 4, we see Nicodemus's reaction to this, and it's as we would expect, right? In verse 4, Nicodemus says, Lord, how can a man be born again when he is old? Nicodemus asks, surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb? And the age reference here, that Nicodemus has kind of given away his life stage? He's obviously, he's a mature man, right? He's asking, how can a man be born again when he is old? And you can see his point, right? As we get older, the shape of our lives begins to set, doesn't it? The concrete, it hardens quickly. And over time, we begin to settle with who we are. And we have less expectation of change. So it's always great to see, young people professing Christ and coming forward to be baptized. That's all great, but how can a man or woman who is in his 50s or 60s or 70s or 80s, Dad, how can a man like that really expect to be born again? I mean, the years have gone by and you cannot get them back. And your life is what it is, right? So Nicodemus asked the question, how can a man be born again when he's old, Jesus? And we get that, right? We get that. We also get that Nicodemus completely missed the point. Completely missed it, right? Because Jesus isn't talking about a physical rebirth. He's talking about a spiritual rebirth. Now, I want to pause. And I was thinking about where to put this in my discussion this morning with you. I want to give you a definition of what it means to be born again. So I want you to listen carefully to what I'm about ready to go through with you. Because this, when you understand this, the rest of this dialogue with Nicodemus and Jesus, it's going to make perfect sense to you. It's going to become crystal clear. So every person is born into this world with a body and a soul, right? Your body is the physical aspect of your being. Your soul is the immaterial aspect of your being. Your soul includes things like your mind, your emotions, your will, your conscience. That's your soul. Now, for the sake of this discussion, there is an aspect of your soul called your spirit. Now your spirit is that part of your soul that communes with God and can respond to God. But according to Ephesians 2, because of trespasses and sins, when you were born, every single person who's ever been born, you're born with a living body, a living soul, and a dead spirit. You're spiritually stillborn. So an unbeliever is a person who's walking around with a living body, a living soul, and they're carrying around a dead spirit, if you will. Now, for a believer, the scriptures use the soul and spirit kind of interchangeably, and you'll see why in a second. So, but understand this, that if you don't have a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, your problem is not that you're a bad person. Your problem is that you're spiritually dead. So come to terms with that. That is the key to understanding what it means to be born again. So since you're spiritually dead, you need God to do a work in you, a miraculous work, and give you life. And he does that in the context of hearing and understanding the gospel message. Now follow the order of things. When an unbelieving person, somebody who is spiritually dead, hears and understands the gospel message, in that context, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in that person. He indwells you permanently and forever when you're saved. And then he does a work in you. The Holy Spirit does a work in you that only God can do. He brings your dead spirit to life. You are spiritually reborn. That's why the Bible calls new believers spiritual babies. You're a spiritual baby. The Holy Spirit awakens in you new desires, new capabilities, and the power to commune with God and respond to God. More importantly, follow this, the Holy Spirit grants you the gift of faith to believe in Jesus, Ephesians 2:8, and he gives you the desire to turn from sin, to repent, Acts 11:18. This is what it means to be born again. And so based on the perfect sinless life of Christ, his substitutionary death on the cross, his burial and his resurrection and his ascension back to heaven, the Holy Spirit comes and he washes away all of your sins and he gives you new spiritual life. So to be born again is completely a work of the Holy Spirit. Interestingly, the phrase born again Christian, it's not in the Bible. I mean, the phrase, born from above and born again and born of the Spirit, they're in the Bible, but that conjunction, born again Christian, it's not in there. Do you know why? It's a completely unnecessary redundancy. It's like me talking about an unmarried bachelor or a three-sided triangle. All bachelors are unmarried and all triangles are three-sided. Me saying an unmarried bachelor and three-sided triangle, it's just extra information that doesn't mean anything. The simple reality is this, that everyone who is truly a Christian is born again. And so consequently, if you have not been born again, you are not saved. You are not a Christian. So based on this understanding of what it means to be born again, let's continue the dialogue. In verse 5, it says that Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of heaven unless he is born of water and the Spirit." Now, you want to read some long sections of commentaries and you want to see lots of books written on things? Look up what it means to be born of water and the Spirit. I'm telling you, I fell asleep multiple times reading about different interpretations of that. Some people think that being born of water and the Spirit speaks of the natural waters of birth. And so Jesus is talking about that. But you know what? Since everyone's already, born naturally, why doesn't Jesus just say you can't enter the kingdom of heaven unless you're born of the Spirit? Now, some people also think it means the waters of baptism. But the problem with that is baptism doesn't cause the new birth. Baptism is something you do as a result of the new birth. And besides, to make baptism required for being born again would contradict basically the entire New Testament. So it can't mean baptism. Being born again, being born of water and the Spirit, refers to the twin blessings of the gospel that run all through Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament. And what are they? They are a new cleansing and a new birth. So what does God do for us when we understand and believe the gospel? He washes away all of our sins based on Christ's death on the cross. We're born of water, and he makes us a new creation by putting his Spirit in us. We're born of the Spirit. And you sense that Nicodemus gets a little, or Jesus gets a little irritated with Nicodemus because he doesn't get this, don't you? Because Nicodemus should have known this. 600 years before Christ was even born, listen to what the prophet Ezekiel wrote. He wrote this from Ezekiel 36. And the Lord said, "A day is coming when I will make a new covenant with my people. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your moral impurities. And then I will give you a new heart and a new spirit, and I will put my Spirit in you." You see, that's the Old Testament's version of what it means to be born again. Water and the Spirit, cleansed and God's Spirit in you. You see, just having your sins forgiven is not enough. Do you know why? Because if God forgave all my sins today, by this afternoon, I'd be back in the same spot, you know? You know, the gospel is far more than God forgiving you. It's more than God saying, "I'll give you a second chance to get it right and prove yourself." Because that'll only lead to the same outcome as before, right? You need both a cleansing of your sins, and you need a new nature with a spirit that's alive and with God's Holy Spirit living in you. These are permanent gifts that come to us through Christ. So continuing on in verse 6, Jesus says, "That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows where it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." In other words, you can't wash away your own sins. You can't cause yourself to be born again. Jesus is saying that the new birth is a work of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit moves like the wind. You can't control where the wind comes from or where it's going. You can't even see the wind, right? We can only see the result of what the wind's doing, but we can't actually see wind. And Jesus is saying this to Nicodemus. He's saying that the change that needs to happen in your life, Nicodemus, the change that really needs to happen in every human life, not only is that change more radical than you thought, but the change that needs to happen is beyond your power. You can't give yourself new birth. And this is, we need to understand how devastating this was to Nicodemus. He's done his very best to obey God's law and live a moral life. And Jesus is saying, Jesus' message is the opposite of Disney's message. Disney's message is, "Hey, you can do it, believe in yourself." And Jesus is saying, "Stop believing in yourself. You can't do it." That's the gateway to starting to understand the gospel. So in verse 9, Nicodemus has kind of given up. He throws up his hands and he just says, "How can this be? How can this be?" Let me take a quick side road and mention something to you. The statement, "You must be born again," is not the gospel. The statement, "You must be born again," is a statement of the problem to which the gospel is the answer. I'm going to say that again. The statement, "You must be born again," is not the gospel. "You must be born again" is a statement of the problem to which the gospel is the answer. So that's the whole point of this discussion here. If you tell someone you must be born again, you haven't told them the gospel. You've merely left them in the same position that Jesus has gotten Nicodemus to here in this conversation. If you do that, if you just tell someone you must be born again, you're like a doctor who who just tells you that you have a problem. You know, come on, you got a problem, you've got and it's massive. But he doesn't give you a cure. He just tells you the problem and says, all right, make sure you pay the receptionist on the way out. You know, so we can't end there, right? We can't end with that. So after identifying with Nicodemus the seemingly impossible need of being born again, Jesus gives him the solution to the problem. So what he says next is massively important. And after a quick reprimand for not understanding what the Old Testament teaches about being born again, Jesus says in verse 13, "No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who is from heaven, the Son of Man, Jesus Christ. He is in a category above all other people. No earthly father, sinless, the only one who has ever been to heaven." And then he says, "Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." There it is. There is the solution to the problem of being born, needing to be born again. Jesus was lifted up on a cross to bring the change that needs to happen in your life and my life. And Jesus uses an Old Testament story that Nicodemus was very familiar with. Moses lifting up a snake on a pole is a reference to Numbers 21, verses 4 to 9. You can read it later if you want, but I'm sure a lot of us might be familiar with the account. The Israelites are in the desert, and they're wandering, and they don't like the way things are going, so they begin to complain against God, something we've all done. So then God does something that, to me, is the most dreadful thing imaginable. He sends venomous, poisonous snakes into the camp, and they begin to bite the people, and they're dying. And so many are dying that the people begin to think, we're not going to make it to the promised land. So they went to Moses and they say, "Moses, we have sinned against God. Please forgive us." So Numbers 21:8 says this, "So Moses prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Moses, 'Moses, make a bronze snake, put it up on a pole, and anyone who is bitten may look at that snake and live.'" And that's an illustration. Jesus uses this illustration to talk about what kind of death he would die. He would be lifted up on the cross to pay for the sins of the world. And by looking at him and believing in him, you can be born again. And the parallel is obvious, right? You know, just as people during that time in the Old Testament, that unique time, could look up at the bronze snake on the pole and receive physical healing, you and I can look at Christ in our hearts' minds and see him paying the penalty for our sins and be forgiven of our sins and receive eternal healing for those sins and have eternal life and be born again. You know, and could people choose not to look at the snake up on the bronze pole? Yeah. What would happen if they didn't look? They would die. Could people choose not to look at Christ up on the cross? What's going to happen to them? They're going to die in their sins. They're going to enter into hell for all of eternity. So you might be, let me close with this. You might be sitting here thinking, you know what? I want that. I want to have my sins forgiven. That sounds good. I want to be made new, but it just sounds too simple. It sounds too simple. I mean, anybody can look to Christ and believe. That's right. Anybody can look to Christ and believe. You don't need a PhD. You don't need to jump through a bunch of hoops. You don't need to keep some long list of rules. Just look to Christ and believe. Isaiah, I don't know the text, but Isaiah says, God says in Isaiah, "Look to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other." It's the message of God to us all throughout Scripture. Look to God and be saved. And just as Moses lifted up the snake on the pole, the Son of Man was lifted up so that all who look to him can be born again and saved. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will never perish but have eternal life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we thank you for speaking to us through your word, and we thank you for making salvation so accessible to all people. that all people can look and believe and be born again. And so this morning, I just want to ask that for those here who don't know you, who have not yet been born again, that today they would abandon all hope of trying to earn their salvation and simply look to you and believe. For those of us who have been born again, who have your spirit within us, we praise you. We praise you for so great a salvation. And we ask that we would be witnesses to those around us in this coming week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Pastor Rick, for sharing the message. Let's stand and sing our final hymn today, Now I Belong to Jesus, hymn number 284.
To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to God our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.